right. Well, thank you so much for coming. My name is Natalie Arbell. I had the pleasure of editing Poornima's new book, How to Transform Your Ideas into Software Products. The book is a step-by-step guide to help you take your idea from the idea stage to a functioning product and maybe even a business. So we're here today with Poornima, as well as our esteemed guest, Ben Congleton, who is a CEO and founder of Olark. And Poornima actually interviewed him for the book. So we'll talk a little bit about their experiences and why now is the right time for you to work on an idea, whether it's alone or with another team. And we'll take questions at the end as well. So we've been working on the book for a while now.
Yeah, we started in April. Or actually, I started in April, and then I got to a point where I was like, I think this might suck. I was having brunch with Bernadette, who's a good friend of Natalie's and a good friend of mine, and I was like, I really need somebody to like read over my work, look at the grammar, make sure I'm using like semicolons correctly, and also make sure that it makes sense. So I met Natalie in July, and we've been working together ever since. Yeah, June or end of June, or like it's all a blur now. Yeah.
It's been a great time. Congratulations.
Thank
on the launch.
Thank you. Yeah.
And in the book, you know, you interview Ben, but you've actually known each other for a few years now, right? So how did you guys meet?
I always tell the story. You want me to tell the story?
Yeah, tell the story.
Okay.
I want to hear your story.
So maybe a lot of you know the Hacker Dojo. Maybe you don't. I mean, now it's in a new location, but about 3-4 years ago, I think it was 2011, the location was like the older one off of Wiseman, and they had this like reverse career fair where like the companies had to pitch the employees that were coming, or like the startup people. And so Ben and I had booths that were like right next to each other. And I remember meeting Ben and being like, oh, like, what's Olark? What do you guys do? And then I also discovered that, you know, he had bootstrapped his business, which was like interesting to me at the time, because I was like, oh, you like just started making money from day one? How fascinating. I never thought of that before. And I had previously been at a venture-backed business, and I also raised some capital for BusyBee. So that was really interesting to me. And then, you know, Ben proceeded to like invite me to stuff. He was like, oh, come do Broom Ball at like 11 p.m. And I was like, I'm really tired, Ben. Let's just like hang out and talk shop. So we kept like meeting up to talk shop. And then funny story, it was like the end of 2011, and we were like doing a Skype session. And he was like, oh, you know, one of my engineers is going to be in Paris, and you said you're going to be in Paris. Like, you guys should meet up. So Aaron, his engineer, and I met up in Paris. And then about 8 months later, started dating. So I have Ben to thank. He's like the full service CEO. He like coaches you and mentors you and like introduces you to like quality people. So yeah, thank you, Ben.
Doubles as a matchmaker.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah.
So when you interviewed him, is there anything that surprised you that you didn't know before?
I think a couple things. I actually, so I'd known that you had been in the PhD program at Ann Arbor,
yeah.
But I didn't know what inspired you to start Olark. So I thought that was fascinating, because I remember you telling me that you had been at a seminar, so something like that.
Yeah, you want me?
Yeah.
All right, sure, I'll jump on in. So Olark is actually the second company that I've started. I started one company back when I was in high school. But like a lot of people were playing like video games and stuff like that, and I decided to, you know, spend my time in a little bit more effective way. And so I ran a web hosting company back in 1998, like right when things were kind of getting excited. And our initial capital for that startup was about $100 that my uncle had loaned us to buy the domain name that we used.
And you were like 14 at the time?
I definitely couldn't drive.
Okay.
But I think my dad had to co-sign our like credit card license so we could accept credit cards, because back then there was no Stripe or PayPal. It was actually pretty hard to get paid. But anyway, so I went through that experience, and then later on, while I was doing a PhD at the University of Michigan, I still sort of had this hosting company on the side, but it had kind of gotten this like, oh, maybe I can have a 4-hour work week kind of business. So it was just like declining. Like we sort of neglected it, and it was kind of making us a little bit of money, but we weren't that happy with it. And so I was sitting in this seminar at the University of Michigan, and I remember reading this article about how the internet is going to allow more disintermediation, which means more businesses and consumers interacting directly with each other, as opposed to having to go through like big marketplaces and lots of middlemen. And I was thinking, like, okay, well, how are these people going to talk to each other if there's more businesses and more consumers? Back when we ran that web hosting company, live chat was really important. Maybe they'll use live chat. So we looked out at the market and we were like, it looks like it's the same guys from 1997. And this is now like 2007, the exact same people. The products were still sort of not so great. Like, they had really focused on like big enterprise companies and not on small guys like us back when we were in, 1998, we were pretty small. We're only just three people. And so I thought, like, okay, well, if there's this future of disintermediation, which means lots more businesses, lots more consumers conducting business, and they need some way to talk to each other, and live chat's basically built for Comcast and AT&T, maybe there's an opportunity to come in there and build the solution that I needed 10 years ago. And we managed to build a prototype and just see if the idea was correct. And it turned out there was an opportunity to get in there and solve a need that we had personally 10 years ago. So it was pretty interesting that that worked out.
Now, you were in school when you did this, so this was definitely a side project.
Absolutely.
And one of the things that the book really encourages people to do is start with a side project. Yeah. How did you find the time? Like, what's your secret?
Well, I don't know. I think, like, maybe I'm a workaholic.
I remember you mentioned that Kat, his wife now, you were like, she was in grad school, so you had a lot of extra time.
It's true. My now wife was in grad school too, so I did work a lot. I almost feel like since high school, basically my like extracurricular activity had been sort of companies. But in any case, when I was doing the PhD at University of Michigan, I was fairly busy with schooling. And so I would basically dedicate Sundays. So I would, get up on Sunday and I'd be like, I'm gonna work like as much as I can on Sunday, try to like do code, do customer service for our customers, and that would be it. Like, I'd just make sure that I allocated a big chunk of time every Sunday towards working on this. And that went on from 2007 to 2009, basically. Like, and it wasn't just me by myself. Like, I went out and I recruited some friends to help me. In fact, the original co-founders of the company back then, the company is called Habla, which means to talk in Spanish. Turns out no one in the US knows how to spell that or say it. So it turned out to be not a great domain name, not name for a company. But so the three guys that we had back then were actually the three guys that I'd started this web hosting company with like 10 years prior. And so we had a lot of experience working together, and we're pretty good at like building our ideas and making them real. And it should be noted that like the chat company, the live chat company we're doing, that was maybe like our fourth or fifth idea that we tried together. And a lot of those ideas maybe just got to like idea stage. Some got prototyped. We actually shipped a plugin for GarageBand because one of those guys was a big digital musician. He's like, oh, wouldn't it be so cool if I could just write software to do like, a plugin for GarageBand to make electronic music. And, oh yeah, there's this huge market for it or something. And so we built that, and there wasn't really a huge market for it. We didn't really know how to market it at all. And
But you bounced back quickly.
Well, we did. I mean, for us, like, these were always on the side. So we didn't jump off head first. We, had our consulting jobs, and we would, and I was doing the PhD, and like, so we had our like main work that we're working on. Then we had sort of our fun work or our side project work, and we just made sure that we allocated enough time to get that stuff done and release it out into the world. So that's kind of how we got started.
Cool. And when you wrote the book, it was also a side project,
Oh, it doesn't feel like that, but yeah, it was. It was my 5 a.m. to 9 a.m., about 3 to 4 days a week side project. That was like the ideal time to write, because not a whole lot of emails would be coming in then, and And it was also, like you said, just allocating that time was good and doing it consistently. And by like Wednesday, I'd get a little bit tired. But I was like, okay, just like one more day, just do it one more day. And that was, it was good to have that sort of rigor. Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm a firm believer in side projects. I think like everything I've ever started that's been some level of success was started as a side project. Mm. Whenever I start something and I'm like, oh, this is like gonna be a business, it like just doesn't do very well. So I've learned that like I should just start small, do the side project, and build it up from there.